Welcome to day 5 already of the 5-day holiday clean eating challenge. I cannot believe the week passed so fast, but there has been a roller coaster of cooking. So I hope this gave you a chance to see how simple it is to substitute some of the foods that we love during the holidays to a healthy alternative so we can stick to our dietary needs even during the holidays. I want you to understand that food is not our enemy. And I love food and I struggled with a lot of digestive issues years ago and candida overgrowth and being estrogen dominant. So I was going through a lot of dietary restrictions and I was missing a lot of food. So it's why, based on that experience and because you inspire me with all the changes that you need to do, you inspire me to experiment in the kitchen and bring all these recipes for a healthy alternative. So when you eat them, are completely guilt-free and they are fueling your body. So this 5-day holiday clean eating challenge helps you understand how to do it, how to substitute, and then how to stick which tools we can use to avoid the temptations and stick to our dietary needs during the holiday season. But we are not done. I brought you to my lab again today because I want to prepare the last part of a meal, which is dessert. Dessert is usually the favorite part of a lot of people during the holidays. So I do recommend that this year, just try to cook one dessert, your favorite one, the one that is gonna be the best, so you avoid overindulging on desserts after you already had your whole meal, and your family is going to be really grateful for that as well. So today I want to prepare a couple of sweets that are really common during the holiday season, and one of them is pumpkin pie, and the other one is gingerbread cookies. So we're going to have some incubation times in between, but we are going to be preparing a low-carb, grain-free, and anti-inflammatory pumpkin pie and gingerbread cookies. So my kitchen already smells like the holidays because I have right here some of the most conventional spices that are used for almost all these desserts, which is cinnamon, clove, ginger, nutmeg, and vanilla extract. Whenever you buy vanilla extract, buy it without alcohol. We don't digest alcohol, so that causes a lot of fermentation, gut microbes imbalance, and inflammation. So, and then these spices that actually are used in these desserts are really good to aid digestion. And cinnamon in particular is also really good to balance your blood sugar. Then as a flour, we are going to be using almond flour. Almond flour or coconut flour, those are the best alternatives when you are sticking to a low carb diet, grain-free diet. This is blanched almond flour, is the best, is the lowest in amount of carbs. And for sweeteners, which is what usually we feel when we get the sugar eye pain or overdose with a dessert, for sweeteners, what we are going to use is two options. So we can make these desserts grain-free, anti-inflammatory, paleo-friendly, or grain-free, anti-inflammatory, strict, low-carb. So for paleo-friendly, we can use honey. And I have this local honey. Ideally, if you use honey, use it raw. So raw honey means that they haven't exposed the honey to high temperatures and destroy all the enzymatic properties and antibiotic properties of the honey. And it's not mixed with anything else. And you want it local because local prevents you from seasonal allergies. It's like a vaccine. When you are taking honey, you take some of the antigens that are in the local plants where you live. So that is creating memory in your immune system. So it's acting as a really good anti-allergy. So local always best. And these are the basics, the basic ingredients to cook every single treat. Then if you are doing apple pie or pumpkin pie, all those are going to change depending on the main ingredient, but the rest is all the same. So you are cooking with me, let's get started. Otherwise, you can always go back to the recording of this video in the same link. So you got an email today with the protocol, always the protocol with you to follow exactly the amounts that we need for our recipes. That's very important when we use this kind of flours. So the other sweeteners, actually, I talk about honey, but the other sweeteners, if we are sticking to really low, low carb, is stevia or monk fruit, zero glycemic index, pure and not mixed with any sugar alcohol that causes more bacteria, overgrowth, fermentation, and inflammation. So we can use it in the powder form or the liquid form. Usually the powder form is more concentrated than the liquid form. And for vanilla, the easiest way to manipulate vanilla is if you get vanilla extract, but actually the cleanest, the most aromatic, and the best is vanilla beans. So how do you use your vanilla beans? So a whole vanilla bean goes for 1 tablespoon of vanilla extract. And basically we just make a cut with a knife in the middle, open, and then with a spoon, just scrape out the seeds and then add the seeds to your dry ingredients. So that is how you will use your vanilla beans. So let's get started with the ginger cookies. We are going to be making together ginger cookies and pumpkin pie at the same time because the dough of the ginger cookie has to stay in the refrigerator for a little bit. So let's take a bowl. And I always say we need to mix the dry ingredients and the wet ingredients separately. So you have 2 options for the recipe. You can make the whole dough adding all the ingredients in a food processor, or just the conventional way of doing it. Let's mix first the dry ingredients in a bowl. So we are going to use 2 cups blanched almond flour. Then we are going to use 1 tablespoon cinnamon. This is what you really want to feel in your cookies. 1 tablespoon cinnamon. We are going to add 2 teaspoons ginger. This is gingerbread cookies. So remember, when you buy fresh herbs or dry herbs, you want to buy them organic always as possible. They have a lot of pesticides, and if they are dry, in a glass container. Then we are going to add clove. Clove and nutmeg always go, just a little bit is enough. So 1/4 teaspoon clove and 1/4 teaspoon nutmeg. And as you can see, I always mix the same spoon with all the spices all together. They're going to be mixed anyway, usually in the same recipes. And we are going to add, let me take it out. I forgot to take it out. 2 very important ingredients for our cookies and our pie always to grow. So we can add baking soda or baking powder. Why I do recommend to add baking soda better on this recipe is because baking soda is going to give the brown color to your gingerbread cookies. So that doesn't mean they are burned. That means is the baking soda is helping in browning a little bit that. So we are going to add 1/2 teaspoon. 1/2 teaspoon baking soda. And Now we have options for our sweetener. So we added the flour, the different spices, and then we have options. If you are using your stevia extract, it's gonna be up to taste. So you have to start experimenting. So half to one teaspoon, I will go for 1 teaspoon. If you think they're not sweet enough, the next time you can add more. And then if you are using the powder, add it right now with the dry ingredients. In my case, I'm going to prepare it paleo. So I'm going to be using honey. So I will add it to the wet ingredients. But if you are using stevia, add it now. And let's just whisk everything together very well, because sometimes the baking soda doesn't mix very well. You can do it with a hand mixer, electric hand mixer as well. Just be sure everything is well mixed. And then now in another container, we put our wet ingredients. And why do we do that? It's because almond flour, coconut flour, they absorb a lot of moist. So you always want to mix them separately before you mix them, before you are going to put it baking. So we are going to use 1 large egg, and we will talk about the vegan alternatives. If you are vegan, that doesn't mean you cannot eat these gingerbread cookies. I have put in the recipe different options for 1 egg. So 1 large egg is usually 1/4 cup measurement. So you can use pumpkin, like just pumpkin puree, as a substitute, or you can also use applesauce, 1/4 cup, or you can do your flax egg or your psyllium egg. But we are going to be using the egg, and those are the binders, whatever is helping, binding everything together. And this egg, it was at room temperature for a while, because I'm using for baking coconut oil. Whenever I'm baking, I love using coconut oil, because gives an extra flavor, like makes your pastry really flavorful. We're using melted coconut oil. You can use avocado oil. You can use melted ghee if you want to. That would be the substitute for butter as well. Or you can use MCT oil. So we are going to be using 1/4 cup. And I have put the egg out from the refrigerator before, because coconut oil tends to solidify with cold temperature. So if I mix it with a cold egg, maybe before I whisk it, it's going to solidify. A little bit more, always look at it from the side. So 1/4 cup coconut oil. And then I'm going to add also the vanilla extract. This is also up to taste, but usually I add about 1.5 teaspoons. More or less 1.5. And the sweetener, because I didn't add stevia on the cookies in the dry ingredients, I'm going to add, for paleo version, I'm going to add the honey. So 4 tablespoons, and usually 4 tablespoons is 1/4 cup. So maybe I'm just gonna add 3. I'm not used to do that much sweetener. Help yourself with your fingers. 1, 2. And 3. Yummy. So let's try to whisk. Use the whisker. It's going to be easier because the honey is a little bit thick. Let's add the coconut oil. I think we added everything. So oil plus egg are the binders in here. So let's whisk. You can whisk your egg also before you add the rest of the ingredients. That's also fine. All right, so we have our paste ready. Now we can add it to the dry ingredients. And I didn't remember to turn on the oven. Like I say every day, first thing we gotta do is turn on the oven, but it's because this is going to be put. It went the way, sorry, let me rinse it. Doesn't really want to work today. So this is going to be in the refrigerator for a few minutes. So now let's mix. The wet into the dry. This looks and it smells yummy already. It smells like cinnamon. All right. So let's mix it all together. Whisker or fork. Until we make a dough, and we need to make a ball with this. All right, so now that is a little bit crumbly, now we have to help it the dough with our hands. If it's too sticky, you can always put a little bit of water in your hands. And because it's a little bit sticky, that is why we are going to put it in the refrigerator for a few minutes. It's also sticky because I use honey. If you use stevia, it's not going to be that sticky. Thank you, Gina. Nice recipes, Gina said. Nice recipes for the holidays. Yeah, these are usually the stars of the holidays. So we have our dough like this. We are going to put it in the refrigerator. I recommend to put it in the refrigerator for at least 30 minutes. So what it's going to do is absorb a little bit the moist and it's not going to be that sticky when we manipulate it. Otherwise, you could use it directly like this. Today with the class, it's not going to be a complete 30 minutes, but I will say try to do it for at least 30 minutes. All right, so we have our ginger cookies in there. So let's start working then on the pumpkin pie. And when I talk about pumpkin pie crust, that means the crust we are going to make can be a crust for an apple pie, for a fruit tart, whatever base of a pie that you want to make. And if you want it for something salty, you don't have to add the spices and the sweeteners in there. So let's get started. We get another bowl. And now is when we are going to preheat the oven before we start mixing at 350 Fahrenheit. And as always, we are going to mix the dry ingredients and the wet ingredients separately. Always, always the same. And it's the same ingredients, so I'm going to be reusing the same bowl for the wet. So basically here, we are going to use another 2.5 cups of almond flour. Remember that if you want to substitute almond flour for coconut flour, is 1 cup of almond flour, 1/4 cup coconut flour, and you need to add more eggs. That is very important, otherwise it gets really dry. So let's measure 2.5 cups almond flour. And this is still blanch. Every time we are baking, I recommend to use blanch. The result is much better and you don't have the skin. And also, why is important that it's blanch? Because if it's not blanch, you don't know if those almonds have been soaked, sprouted, or dry roasted. And why is that important? It's because raw nuts have phytic acid, which is going to block your digestive enzymes and cause a lot of mineral deficiency. The way to eliminate it is dry roasting, sprouting, or soaking. So if they eliminate the skin, we are not going to have that problem. So 2.5 cups. You can also substitute, instead of 2.5 cups of almond flour, you can do one of the cups. You can do 1.5 almond flour and 1/4 cup coconut flour. You can also do that. If you don't want to use that much almond flour. I think we have already. Yeah, this is a little bit more I have to take out. Here, when we bake with coconut flour, almond flour, a little bit more doesn't work. Or it's going to be like a rock. Right, so we have already 2.5. And if you want the sweetener just on the filling of the crust, you don't have to do it. Otherwise, you can add sweetener. So in this case, I'm going to add the stevia extract in here. For non-paleo crust. Otherwise, you could add honey when you mix it with the liquid ingredients. I'm gonna add whatever I have left from my powder, which is 1/4 teaspoon. Or if you are using vanilla, liquid vanilla, you add it with the wet ingredients, not with the dry ingredients. I'm gonna add just a little pinch of salt. Always, even baking, we add salt. That helps with the texture. I'm preventing any mold formation as well. And it will be all the dry ingredients. It's just the stevia, the salt, and the almond flour. How simple. Let's just mix everything together. And this pie that I'm making today has a vegan option as well. All recipes can be transformed from non-vegan into vegan. So every day I'm giving you the alternative. Okay, so we have the dry. Let's mix the wet. So in this case, I'm going to be using also 1 large egg. For baking this with this kind of flours, it's always better large eggs. But if you are vegan, you can substitute 1 egg for 1/4 cup hot water, which is 4 tablespoons hot water. So you can do that for the crust. So it's a little bit crunchy. You don't want it too chewy. So 1 egg, then the other part of the binder always is oil. So MCT oil, avocado oil, coconut oil, melted ghee, perfect on a dairy-free anti-inflammatory diet. So I'm going to be using melted 1/3 cup coconut oil perfect 1/3 cup. And if you would have your liquid sweetener now, you would add it here. Since I already added to the dry ingredients, that is fine. That could be honey, or that could be the stevia. And basically, this is it. We just whisk everything together. Very simple crust. If you want to make it chocolate, you add cacao powder onto the dry ingredients. So what I would do is remove half. So if we added 2.5 cup of almond flour, just use 2 cups of almond flour and 1/2 cup of baking powder. Baking chocolate, cacao powder. So that would be a chocolate crust. So let's whisk with energy. Very good. This is a dough that you can also make in the food processor. You, instead of mixing dry ingredients one side and wet ingredients in the other side, just put everything in the food processor and just make the dough. And now we are going to mix again the wet into the dry. Always wet into the dry. How are we doing there? Anybody cooking? All right. Let's mix it well until we prepare kind of like a dough. Same way as the cookies. Very simple and gluten-free. Instead of going to the supermarket and buy those pre-made crust for your pie that have tons of additives, preservatives, really bad for your body. How simple is to make it? And you can make it in advance. This is something that you can pre-make in advance. Just make the dough, put it in the pie mold and freeze it. You can also do that. Okay, now we are going to help ourselves with the hands. You can freeze it after you bake it, or you can freeze it before you bake it. But if you don't want it to get too dry, I will recommend freeze it after you bake it, and then you can decide later on which kind of filling you are going to be using with your pie. So we are getting a bowl. This. So we have kind of like a bowl. If it's too dry, you can add a little bit more of oil. Maybe I'm going to do that just a little bit. Very good. And now it's time to put it in your pie mold. So you can put it on a cake, spring form as well, or you have a pie mold, silicone mold, stainless steel, whatever you have, it's all good. So this is a 9-inch, but you can do a 8-inch or an 8.5. That's fine. We're gonna put it here. Are we going to start pushing with our hands to cover? And by the way, you can put also a little bit of oil. I didn't do it, but before you put the dough, you can put a little bit of oil so you prevent that get too stuck in the bottom. Usually the coconut-based ones, they get more stuck in the bottom than the almond. So we see we are pushing everything well until we make a thin layer that is more or less like 1/4 inch. And we want to go up high to the sides. Start going higher. The oven is ready. Just perfect timing. That's why always remember to put it first. This is getting a good shape. And don't worry, you don't have to be perfect. The edges don't have to look perfectly all the same. The flavor is going to be amazing. And you know, sometimes people are scared of putting hands in the kitchen cooking because they feel it doesn't look great. But believe me, a lot of those perfect foods that show out there, they are not even food. They are plastic models they put to show you the food. Homemade, that's what is important. All right, so I keep pushing. It's going up. So this week here at home, preparing all these recipes, we've been eating already holiday. Kitchen smells like holidays. I hope you have seen the results. I put it in the private group, the Kitorenian Diet Solution. All the photos of the results of the recipes. So put it all the way until you get the edge outside. Even if it looks like the dough is small, stretch a lot. Just keep pressing with your fingers. Perfect. That's it. Oh, I can't wait to eat this. I have a sweet tooth. I always have a sweet tooth. In my house, we all have a sweet tooth. But this is totally guilt-free. All right, so I think that's it. The pie crust is ready. So we are going to put it in the oven for about 18 to 22 minutes. That's what I have put here because it really depends on your oven. So on the middle rack, let's put it in there. I'm gonna start with 15 minutes. So you want it to be completely done because we are not putting it back in the oven. The rest of the recipe is all raw. So how simple it is. You don't have to bake your pumpkin pie again, just the crust. So let me wash the hands a little bit to keep going. Perfect. So now we imagine that the cookies have been in the refrigerator for 30 minutes, right? So it's time to take them out. So we have our dough dryer already. It's easier to manipulate, doesn't get that stuck in your hands. And now we have two options to make the cookies. So we will preheat the oven at 350. We already have it because of the pie. But we have two options. So one, you want to make perfect ginger cookies with a mold. You have the gingerbread man. You want to make those cookies. Well, for example, I have here other molds like hearts, like snow stars, angels, the pine tree, the Christmas tree. So you can just play around. You want to use cookie cutters, that's fine. Otherwise, to make it simple, you can just make them round. What is important is that they have to be around half an inch. If you make them too thick, they are not going to be that sweet and they are too crunchy. If you make them half an inch, they are more chewy. So that it depends also, you like them crunchy, quarter an inch. If you like them chewy, half an inch. So if we want to make with the cookie cutter, let's make a few with the cookie cutter. So what we need is parchment paper. Here. Never foil paper to put in the oven. Foil, aluminum foil is releasing a lot of aluminum when you put it, when you expose it at high temperature. So never put aluminum in the oven. So we are using parchment paper. So we will take the whole dough and we'll put it in the parchment paper, between two parchment paper, and then we flatten to make the cookies. I'm not gonna do the whole dough, I'm just going to show you the two options. One with the molds, the other one just round cookies, which are still delicious and they are easier. So let's take the dough, put it here. Just flatten with your hands a little bit, always you help it. Take the rolling pin and just flatten to half an inch, not too thin, like the crackers. When we made the crackers, that was thinner. So just a little bit. Even this, I think it's 1/4 inch. So I'm just gonna fold it to make it a little bit thicker. You can even do it with your hands. That depends how perfect you want your cookies to look like. All right. So basically, I have 1 inch. I'm gonna reuse this. Always reuse everything. This parchment paper, I'm gonna reuse to bake the cookies. And just with a cookie cutter, just make cookies. So we have a heart. Put it in there. We have a Christmas tree. So sometimes they stay in there. So you just take a spatula and take it, or they stay in here. So carefully take them out. Leave some space, like more or less like 1 inch from each other. Just have fun. Have fun with the cookies. This usually yields about 10 big cookies or 25 small, if you make it everything like this kind of small. All right, I have a space for one more. And just, you know, when you have the leftover, just put them together again in a bowl and keep cutting cookies. How pretty. So we will do, so we will put it again in a bowl. We just keep cutting 1/2 inch cookie. It's too big. And just keep going. And then if you don't have cookie cutters, don't worry, you're gonna still make gingerbread cookies. So basically what we would do, we take the whole dough. Don't leave anything behind. And just make balls. Just either ball like this. And we have two options. We just mash with our hand a little bit to 1/2 inch. You can make a little bit of decoration with your fork, maybe like this. So you have the squares in the middle, and that's it. That's your cookie. So this is even faster. Just keep making balls. Flatten a little bit. Use the fork on one side and the other. Try to leave, as I said, 1 inch from each other. So you're gonna need more than one tray, like I'm gonna need. You can directly, instead of flattening with your hand, you can just take the fork and flatten. Either way, with your hand, or like this. If you do it just with the fork, it gets a little bit smaller compared to the other one. I have another one with parchment paper. And you can reuse this parchment paper to keep baking the rest. Okay, so let's make all balls. Question we have, if you use 1/2 of the almond flour and 1/4 cup coconut flour, do you add just 1 more egg? You may need to add 1 more, but maybe 2 large is too much. Maybe 1 large and 1 medium or small. But because you are not substituting just all the almond flour for coconut flour, you may not need it. So yeah, keep an eye But yeah, you may need extra egg. Yeah, very good question. All right, so we have all the cookies. I made some a little bit big. But yeah, we got a good yield. So flatten with the fork, just like this. Or flatten with your hand. And then you don't have to put the decoration of the fork, it's just to add some extra nice touch. You can also add nuts on the top. So you can decorate your ginger cookie. Like if you are making a gingerbread man, just take nuts, dry cranberries, dry blueberries, and put ice on it or little buttons. But yeah, don't put those colorful bad things that they sell to make your cookies. We're almost done. Oops. They're sticky because I made it with honey. With the stevia is not. Actually, with this big one, I feel like making an angel. I didn't make an angel. Maybe it's just. Yeah, it's just too. Half an inch angel. Beautiful. With the rest, I just make a ball. All right, so this would be the ginger cookies. We have them all ready, and the ginger cookies are going to bake in just 10 to 12 minutes. That's it, depending on your oven. So we have already the oven preheated for the pie. So we are going to put the cookies next to a pie in the middle rack. Oh, the pie looks good. So the ginger cookie has to be a little bit longer. We have 4 minutes left for the pie. So we have time to make the filling of the pie. All right. Let's clean this mess a little bit. So what you are going to need for the filling is just a blender. That's all. So no more bowls. The magic ingredient. So let's bring the blender here. You need a high-speed blender. Right here. So pumpkin pie, some people consider it paleo, and they say it cannot go on a low-carb diet, but pumpkin can go on a low-carb diet, and actually it's a really good way to make vegan eggs. Quarter cup of pumpkin puree is one large egg. So pumpkin is on the menu. It depends how much of the pumpkin you are going to use, and that is on low-carb diet where we play is also with ratios. So it's low carb, high fat, moderate protein. So if the rest of the ingredients that we are using to mix together with the pumpkin are fatty enough, high in fat and high in protein, it's decreasing the ratio of the carbohydrate that we have in the pumpkin by itself. And of course, you're not gonna eat the whole pie, you're gonna eat one piece. The whole pumpkin pie goes for about 10 persons, 10 servings, all right? So what we are going to use for our pumpkin pie filling, and before I continue, as I said, that crust, you can use it for anything else. You can use it to make an apple pie as well. You can make double of that one. So if you are making an apple pie, you have to make double recipe of the crust. You use half one of that one to make the base, and then you make another batch of the crust, flatten between two parchment papers with the rolling pin, and then you will put it on top of the pie. Like whenever we make the apple pie, we have the crust, we have the apples, and then we put another layer of the crust. So this would be the same. You make double amount of the crust, one for the bottom and one for the top, all right? And the one of the top, you just make it flat with a rolling pin between two parchment papers. I also love that crust if you are making a fruit tart. You have like pastry cream inside and then you put some fruits on the top. That is amazing. Or if you are making a blueberry tart or pie as well, that is good. So then let's work with our pumpkin pie and what we are gonna mix it with to make the richness of the carbs a little bit lower. But the crust, I think, is ready. It was 15 minutes. Let's put 6 more minutes for the cookies. The cookies total 10 to 12 minutes until they are golden. I like the crust like this, but maybe I'm gonna leave it just a couple more minutes. So let's put 2 more minutes the crust because I'm not gonna bake it with anything else. If you are making an apple pie and you have to put it in the oven again, just bake it maybe for 15 minutes because you don't want to have it too brown before you bake it again. But since we are not gonna bake it again, I want to be sure it's well done. So I'm putting it for another extra 2 minutes. So basically take your blender and we are going to add the pumpkin puree, all the ingredients. So we have 2 cups pumpkin puree. What's in here? So which pumpkin puree you should buy? So you can make your own pumpkin puree like I did. You buy the pumpkin, scoop out the seeds, and boil it until it's completely done, and that will be your pumpkin puree. You just mash it after you boil it, and that's the puree. Otherwise, if you buy it on a can, you want to be sure that is BPA-free lining, the can, and is organic, because pumpkin has to be organic. So 2 cups of organic pumpkin puree. Then the other liquid that we are going to add is coconut oil or MCT oil or avocado oil. So we are adding 1/3 cup . Actually, I have to add a little bit more. I'm going to add MCT oil because I don't have more melted coconut oil. You can mix them. This actually is a really good example of how you can mix oils. I'm going to take the crust out. Maybe the ginger cookies are also looking good. Yeah, this is done. So let me show you, without burning myself, how it looks like. So the crust is done. It's beautiful. This is gonna flatten down now when it's gonna start cooling down. And this is something that you could already, whenever it's completely cooled down, you just freeze it like this until you are ready to use it. Otherwise, let's leave it cooling down a little bit before we add the rest of the filling. Perfect. So 1/3 cup, 2 cups pumpkin puree, 1/3 cup high smoke point oil. Or in this case, we are not cooking it. Doesn't have to be a high smoke point oil, but because it's a dessert, I don't really like to add olive oil because the flavor is going to change. Then we're going to add vanilla extract. So for the vanilla without alcohol, I'm going to add 1 teaspoon, maybe 2. I really like vanilla flavor on my pumpkin pie. See, this is also with the flours, we cannot play. Whatever is the amount of the flour that we need, that is what we add. But for spices and sweetener, you can just play with it. Just add more or less, depending on your taste. Then we are going to add the sweetener. So for 0 glycemic in the sweetener, we add liquid vanilla or vanilla extract in powder. Or for paleo version, which is what I'm going to do today. Today, I'm into a paleo. I'm going to add some honey. So for honey, you can do 3 to 4 tablespoons. I will go for 3. Don't go too high. But if you really want to cut your carbs down, just add stevia. Stevia or monk fruit. Just 2 tablespoons. Honey. Sorry, I have to eat the rest from my finger. So we have the puree, we have the oil, the vanilla, the sweetener, and now what smells? What is the smell of the pumpkin pie? The spices that we said at the beginning that are used for every single dessert. For holidays, so we have the cinnamon, the ginger, and the nutmeg. So we are going to add 1/2 teaspoon of cinnamon. If you like it pretty cinnamon, you can even add 1 teaspoon. I'm going to add 1/2, heaping. Then for ginger, I'm going to add 1 teaspoon. I really like to find the ginger flavor, so 1/2 and 1/2. And then for a nutmeg, I'm going to be adding 1/4 teaspoon. 1/4 to 1/8 teaspoon. Always nutmeg and clove. I'm not adding clove in here. Oh, actually, this is 1/2 teaspoon and a 1/4 teaspoon. The cookies are calling us. Let's see. Oh, yeah, they look good. So I left it for 10 minutes. I think I'm going to take them out. If you like them more golden, you can leave them for a couple more minutes in the oven. Otherwise, if you don't want them to burn, then just 10 minutes is enough. So let's see how beautiful. Look at these cookies. They grow. So it's why I leave it half an, like 1 inch in between. Look at the big ones. They look good. Let's take the other ones. Nothing to envy to the conventional white flour cookies. Beautiful and smell delicious. So I know you got the temptation already to put your fingers in, but let them cool down completely before you eat them. Delicious. All right, so let's keep working on the filling. So we have the pumpkin puree already. We have coconut oil, we have the spices like cinnamon, ginger, nutmeg. In there we have the sweetener, stevia, monk fruit, or for paleo, honey goes very well. Always a little pinch of salt, just a little pinch of salt for preserving. And then what is going to make our our filling to solidify because we are not baking it and it's vegan. Usually non-vegan pumpkin pie will have some eggs and then we will have to put it in the oven again for baking, but we are making a vegan filling. So what is going to glue and make it to solidify? So one of the ingredients is xanthan gum. So xanthan gum is the fermentation of sucrose, glucose, and lactose with a bacteria. So after the fermentation, there is precipitated and it's becoming a powder and it's really good for thickening, but you only need a tiny amount for a whole pie. Don't abuse too much from xanthan gum because if you add too much or you are eating it regularly, if you have really severe gastrointestinal inflammation, you can get some sensitivities. But otherwise, we're using just half to one teaspoon of xanthan gum. And it depends if you like it creamy, half a teaspoon. If you like it more thick cheesecake texture, one teaspoon. And then the other ingredient is the coconut cream that solidifies in the refrigerator. This is going to really give the thick consistency to your pie. So let's open it. So these cans, I had them refrigerated for more than a week, but usually an overnight refrigeration is enough, but for a lot of these recipes requires the coconut milk fat. So whenever you buy always coconut milk, always keep some cans in the refrigerator, always. And I try to be sure that my husband is not opening to get the milk. So we have them ready. So we are going to use 1 cup of the coconut milk fat that usually is from 2 cans. Unless you have a milk that almost everything is coconut cream, you will have 1 can. Let's see. But just in case, we don't know, we put at least 2 cans in the refrigerator. We're going to take 1 cup. And then as you can see, today I'm throwing everything. As you can see, more or less solidify, not too much, but it separated the cream from the water. The water is in the bottom, the cream is on the top. So we put it there. If you buy directly coconut cream, you can just do 1 cup of coconut cream. You don't have to do this, but I personally like to take the layer of coconut cream better than buying the coconut cream itself. Some coconut cream brands are not really coconut cream. They're really, really liquidy, like if it would be coconut milk. So just spend less money on coconut milk and keep it refrigerated. I don't want to risk it too much because I start seeing the water in there. So I'm gonna go for the other one. So look at this cream. This is so good. Very good. So we need 1 cup. I think we are almost there. And coconut cream, when it's in the refrigerator, solidifies. We have it here. The water is there. The cream is there. It solidifies, so that is why we can use it to solidify our pies. If you wanna make a blueberry puree pie, just instead of using 2 cups of pumpkin puree, you use 2 cups of blended blueberries, and then the rest, it would be the same. So I will put this back in the refrigerator. So we have 1 cup of the coconut cream. Let's add it here. It smells really good. The ginger cookies smell really, really good. And now, before we add the xanthan, this is a very important step. Before we add the xanthan, we blend everything together. Very noisy. I love this blender, but it's really noisy. The first time when I bought it, I didn't know it was this noisy, and I was afraid of the neighbors complaining. Actually, they have it too. So when you use the cream from coconut milk, how do you use the water that is left over? So you can use it for another recipe, but coconut water is usually higher in carbohydrates. But then a really good way to use it, if you are sure that you eliminate completely all the cream, is for coconut water kefir. So just take that water, that is coconut water, fermented with the bacteria to make coconut water kefir. So that is a really good way to use it, because the bacteria is going to eat the sugar from the water. So let's add the xanthan. So how do we add the xanthan? I'm gonna add quarter, half a teaspoon. Half a teaspoon, we have it here. So how do we add it? Because all these thickeners, arrowroot, xanthan, they tend to get clumpy as soon as we put them with the liquid. What I do, I add it while I am blending. So I'm going to put the blender again running, and then I'm going to add it while it's blending. So that is a very, very important trick. Every time you are trying to use xanthan gum to solidify something, or agar, for example, I have put that you can substitute xanthan with agar powder, which is an algae, the same ratio, 1:1. Always add it while you are blending, so you prevent gluing. The same for gelatin, for any kind of thickener that you use. All right, so now that you can, ideally, you want to leave your crust cooling completely, but this is cool down. So you see, it got flattened in the middle. It was a little bit bumpy when we took it out. It got more flattened. Yeah, so this is crunchy. It's going to be crunchy. But if you think it's a little bit dry, the crust, as I said, just add one more egg, and one more egg would go for quarter cup more water. That's also fine. So that would be less, more chewy, less crunchy for the crust. Instead of one egg, two eggs. Look at this color. This is beautiful. Let's put everything in here. It's going to be delicious. And usually, how do we serve the pumpkin pie? With whipped cream, right? So you would make whipped cream with the coconut fat that we get, like, put a couple of cans in the refrigerator of coconut milk, then scoop out the fat, and that you whip it with stevia, and that is coconut whipped cream. Very simple. Let's be sure we take everything out. And because this is not big, I recommend to leave it overnight. Usually set there after 3 hours, but it's going to be better after an overnight refrigeration. Yeah, every time you have something with coconut, agar, try to do an overnight refrigerator. I think I mostly scoop out everything. And if you have a big dish, and you think you need more filling, just double up the recipe, triple the recipe, depending how many pies you want to make. Just prepare accordingly, that's fine. I think that's it. And then now we spread. This is a 9-inch. Move it well so you don't get any bubbles on the top. Otherwise, it's going to solidify with the bubbles. Make it smooth. And place in the refrigerator overnight. You can cover it a little bit. Try not to touch. Actually, the trick also is you can cover it with a plastic wrap that is BPA free and touch the cream. So then the cream is not going to get brownish on the top like usually get. Otherwise, just a regular cover, that would be enough. But be sure that cools down a little bit more the container and the crust before you put it in the refrigerator.